In the dumpster and had a raccoon stuck there. And then took a while for us to take that raccoon out of there because it seems like he didn't want to leave, you know? But I think we got it out, right, Steph? Yeah.
Well, that's true. Yeah, Stephanie has one too.
Yeah, so I had some food outside, a whole bag of Danish rolls that I was looking forward to. And the raccoon came and took it all away. And I also had this experience where the raccoon ate my chips. And it did it in such a way that I couldn't tell because it didn't tear the bag. And one of my friends actually videotaped the raccoon eating my chips. And it used its front feet like hands, you know, and stuck it in the bag and ate. It was very cute to see, but disappointing.
There was a similar experience that we had as well, where one of my friends, she had a bin on the outside where she put food in, and the raccoon actually went into it, took what was on top, and took the chips that was underneath, and put the food back. So she didn't even know that her chips
was
gone.
Wow.
And it closed the
So they're known for what? What? Overcoming obstacles, right? Being very creative and very intelligent. I remember when I was at Andrews University, we were renting a house, myself and some other people, and we had a bird feeder. We had at the back door, we had like a little porch that went down by steps into a yard behind, and we had a bird feeder that was just at the base step. And we had also chipmunks and all kinds of things in the backyard. And we started noticing that the bird feeder was going down really quick, and the birds were coming in the morning, and we couldn't, you know, they weren't having enough seed. So we were thinking, what's going on? So we tried to find like different times of day when we could spy on and see if anything was happening. Eventually we saw chipmunks were getting into it. And so we moved it to a different place, and still it was kind of being empty. We're like, man, these chipmunks are eating a lot of these seeds. How can they eat so much? And eventually what we did is we said, okay, we're gonna put the bird feeder way further out there than a chipmunk can jump to, because they can't climb the pole, but we thought they were jumping onto it. And so sure enough, we did that, and the bird feeder was still being empty. It was just baffling us. How can these chipmunks empty the bird feeder? And then one evening, my roommate, he heard this scratching sound. He's like, what's that? It's the middle of the night. And then he went to the window, and he looked out, and he sees in the distance these bright eyes in the middle of the night that look up to him like this. And it was the raccoon. The whole time it was the raccoons that were emptying it. And something that struck me there is that they are very creative, and they have a way of overcoming obstacles. Mm-hmm. If you try to do one thing, they'll do another to be able to get what. So they had created this actual way that they could get up onto the bird feeder without anybody realizing it. And it was just really very interesting. On the back here, it's talking about creativity. The definition of creativity is thinking about a situation, a task, or an idea in a new way. So sometimes in life, we have obstacles, right? We might have challenges that were unforeseen. We might have things that we weren't expecting. And if we give up quick, then we might not have the blessing of trying to persevere and find new ways to overcome obstacles. And that's one of the aspects of perseverance that the raccoon can teach us, creativity. So there are different ideas of ways that we can incorporate these lessons into our lives, use our talents for good, see things from more than one perspective, use principles to make decisions and solve problems, and look for new ways to do things. Mm-hmm. So that is what the raccoon can teach us.
I just remembered one incident that happened. We went with my family to for camping, and my aunt had put the garbage bag, like she had hung the garbage bag really high on the pole, and those metal poles that you can really, like if a raccoon or something would try to climb up, it wouldn't be able to. And then the next morning, or no, she hadn't put garbage, I think she had put food, I don't remember exactly, like it was gone. Like they had managed to come in a raccoon. And so she's like, oh, it's gotta be the raccoon. And then later on we realized that there was a rope that was hanging from the pole, so it seems like it found a way to go and climb through a tree or somewhere else to be able to pass through the rope and then get to the food. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And that's what they're known for, finding ingenious ways to get what they're looking for.
Mm-hmm. Genius ways. There, go ahead and set that down there on that character book. Thank you so much. How many of you have creativity? I hear so many mothers say, I don't have any creativity. And they're trying to homeschool their children And one of the things that you're teaching children at an early age is to be creative.
That's right.
Because what? We have a creator who's creative. Very creative. And when you look at all these things that he's created, oh, what a mind. We're actually looking at God's mind, his thoughts. His thoughts made visible. And so that's why he wants us to study them and to look at them and to look at their genius ways. Because God has given them those abilities. So it's interesting to me, you mentioned how we could use creativity, but you didn't tell us what you use.
Oh, it's your mind.
Oh, and what part?
The frontal lobe.
Oh, and what's it called?
Reason.
And? That's part of it, is the will. The will, that's what you use. And we're going to talk about the will, and we talked a little bit yesterday about it. Good morning. And Mother, good morning.
Good morning.
John 7:17 says, for if any man will, here we go, will do his will, God's will, he shall know of the doctrine. So we're going to talk a little bit about the will today. If you would know the mystery of godliness, you must follow the plain word of truth. Feeling or no feeling, emotion or no emotion. Obedience must be rendered from a sense of principle, and the right must be pursued under all circumstances. This is the character that is elected of God unto salvation. Now, let's get into the test of a genuine Christian. That's my son. Can you tell which one? Not the one with the glasses. The other one. Because that's David, David Michael. He's 36 now. And that Ark of the Covenant was something my brother made. And the mercy seat opened up, and these tables of Two tables, Ten Commandments were inside, and so they were reading the Ten Commandments, and the letters are Hebrew letters on the outside. All right, John 14, we're going to look at John 14, 15, 21, 23, and 24. 15, if ye love me, what? Keep my commandments. 21, he that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him and will manifest myself to him. Do you want God to manifest himself to you?
Yes.
Yes, and he wants to. We can't see him, but he wants to manifest his character to us. So that as we see him, his character, we will be changed into that likeness. Verse 23, Jesus answered and said unto him, if a man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our abode with him. The fullness of the Godhead can dwell in us. And that's what we want. That's what happened with Jesus. 24, he that loveth me not keepeth not my sayings, and the word which ye hear is not mine, but the Father's which sent me. Here are the conditions upon which every soul will be elected to eternal life. Your obedience to God's commandments will prove your right to an inheritance with the saints in light. God has elected a certain excellence of character, and everyone who through the grace of Christ shall reach the standard of his requirement will have an abundant entrance into the kingdom of glory. Beautiful. Conditions. There are conditions. And obedience. What in the room right now can remind us of obedience? Look at your neighbor.
ears.
Pardon?
Her ears, maybe.
Her ears, good. Well, that's good. Yeah, so everybody has ears, right? But in Revelation, it says he didn't have an ear. So not everybody uses those ears the way that the Spirit wants you to use them, right? So we all have ears, so this can remind us of obedience, because that's what obedience means when you look it up in the concordance. It means to hear. So in the Bible, it says hearken, hearken. What does hearken mean? Is the word ear and hearken? Yeah. Oh, also, what other words have the word ear? Forbear. Forbear. So that's again the quality of God. Does this remind you of anything? I wore my white cloak today. So I look medical. My daughter says, I'm not medical, Mom. Do you have to go to UT Pines to be medical? You have to be a Christian, right? Because all Christians need heart work. So the word hear is in heart. Yes, word hear. To hear, to obey. I've had these for years. I took a CNA course, how many years ago now? 15 years ago. I worked just a little bit as a CNA, so I didn't use them. I don't think I ever used them. I just used the blood pressure cup and listening to your heart. Anyhow, I use it to teach children. Use it to see what their heart is doing, how it sounds. Anyhow, okay, so God wants us to hear, hearken, obey his commandments. And in that way, we say, I love you. When your parents, children, when your parents ask you to do something, command you to do something, and you go, okay, and you just keep doing what you're doing, and you don't do it. Are you saying I love you to your mom? No. And parents understand that, and hopefully children will learn that that's the way it is, yes?
Can I read just something that I'll be reading?
Yes, out of what book?
By Taylor Bell. I recommend everybody to go. So it says that obedience on the basis of legality or obligation to duty becomes burdensome and even insipid. But when love is the ruling principle, submission to authority is a pleasure.
Amen. And that's what sometimes parents, sometimes teachers, sometimes bosses, sometimes people don't understand how to combine love with your commands, your laws, your authority.
Because you can tell the difference when, like, a teacher or an authority is telling you something with love, even though it's a rebuke. You're like, wow. This person really cares.
Yeah. What does it touch? Touches the heart. Love touches the heart. And the world celebrates once a year, Valentine's Day. We just had it in February. When all the world is thinking about love. But what kind? Where's God? It's Valentine. No. Every day we want to think about love so we can be changed into that kind of love, that agape love of God. All right, let's go to the next slide. All who would reach this standard of character will have to employ the means that God has provided to this end. If you would inherit the rest that remaineth for the children of God, you must become a what? Co-laborer with God. A co-laborer. Do children become co-laborers with their parents? Mm-hmm. Hopefully, yes. A co-laborer. When you go to work for someone, you are a co-laborer. When you become a member of a church, you are a co-laborer. Learning to work with others. In the body, did you learn about the different systems and how they work together? Mm-hmm. Yeah, when one isn't working right or is sick, it affects all of them, doesn't it?
Yes.
Yes. So you are elected to wear the yoke of Christ, to bear his burden, to lift his cross. You are to be diligent use that word again, that character quality, that divine character quality, 2 Peter 1:10, to make your calling and election sure. That's in 2 Peter also. Search the scriptures and you will see that not a son or a daughter of Adam is elected to be saved in disobedience to God's law. The world makes void the law of God, but the Christians are chosen to sanctification through obedience to the truth. They are elected to bear the cross if they would wear the crown. Now we're going to come over here to the sanctuary set up over here. Where does sanctification take place?
No man can call
comprehend the mystery of godliness so long as he is ashamed to bear the cross of Christ. None will be able to discern and appreciate the blessings which Christ has purchased for man at infinite cost to himself, unless they're willing to joyfully sacrifice earthly treasures that they may become his followers. Infinite cost. Infinite cost. How many of you have a car? Do cars cost a lot of money today? They are incredibly high. Years ago when I got my first car, I had made payments, I think it was $300 a month for 3 years, and then the car started falling apart. But at that time, it was only like $5,000, $4,000 or $5,000 for, you know, a car. It was a Capri, and it was a Ford. But then, many years later, I was given a car, the car that I have now, which is 17 years old. Did you know that cars last that long? That's an old car. But God takes care of his things, doesn't he? He does. And one of the most important things to me was that I kept oil and water in it. Oil and water. That's like the Holy Spirit, right? And you have to keep water in you and oil, of course, in the right form. But when I look at this infinite cost, that car was given to me. It's very expensive. There's no way that I could, especially as a missionary or a mother, single mother, could have afforded that car. But it was given to me. And I wasn't even asked what kind I wanted. Guess what? I wasn't really looking. Because we're at 2020 right now, and the year 2000, that's when there's going to be the crash of the computers, right? Year 2000. I was being given a home at that time. I was given a car at 2003. So I wasn't looking for material things. Guess what? When your heart isn't in the material things, is God going to give them to you? He's going to give them to you because he knows he can trust you with them. Because we can just go, you know, there was one car that this person was going to give me, and I could not see myself driving it. Driving it. At that time, I was working at Heartland, and I couldn't see myself driving down, you know, Heartland's drive in that car because, to me, it was a luxury car. Missionaries don't drive luxury cars. I mean, for me. And anyhow, that wasn't the car. But this person asked my sister what car I would like. And so that's the one that I had, is the one that she thought that would I would like. And I have loved it over the years. But what I'm getting at is when I went to the dealer, and he was trying to sell me insurance for 5 years for that car. And I said, well, that's really something. I said, could I ask you a question? I said, what do you have in your refrigerator at home? Not too much. And then he listed, you know, Cokes and, you know, all this bad stuff. And I said, you would want me to get insurance for this expensive car when an infinite price has been paid for you and your life, for eternal life. He goes, oh. That really alarmed him. I didn't get the insurance. But the main thing was I was able to drop some seeds of truth into that heart, and that was my, that's what I love to do. I love to tell people about Jesus, about the truth. So material things, just like when we're in heaven, we're walking on streets of gold, it is not the gold, it is not the silver. If I would have brought gold and silver today, so that everybody would know that I have gold and silver, would that make me feel comfortable? Not today. If you don't have insurance on the things that are of value in your home, there's thieves. Thieves that they, and hungry people today. People are killing for less than gold and silver. A lot of people today don't even know there was a commercial. And this man was going around the beach area, and he was interviewing people. And he had silver, looked like a Snickers bar, but of course not brown. It was silver. And then he had a chocolate bar. And so he would go up to people and he'd ask them, which one do you want? I'll give you either one. And most of the people, if not all, asked for the Snickers bar. People people that young people especially don't know today was, I think it was a silver bar. Silver bar worth hundreds of dollars. Gold is worth thousands. But God is telling us there's something more valuable than even gold. But he put gold to represent the spiritual life. And the gold represents, what does it represent spiritually?
Faith
and love. That's what God wants us to put first, even before money. Even before gold and silver. My daughter used to say, Mom, you're okay as long as you have something in your bank account. Well, yeah, today, if you don't have money, what can you do? Well, you have to have a lot of faith. And then you have to, of course, be working for God. And he leads you to where you can be taken care of as long as you are working to serve others. So infinite cost has been paid for your salvation. And we have gold. In the holy and most holy place. That's what you receive as you add to your faith. As self decreases, what increases? Every self-denial and sacrifice made for Christ enriches the giver. Wow, you want to be enriched? How about bread today? Usually you can find white bread that's enriched. Or you look on the label, it's maybe some crackers. Enriched. Enriched. Is that the better bread? No. But God wants to enrich us with what? What does he want to enrich us with? His character. That's right. Every suffering and reproach endured for his dear name increases the final joy and immortal reward in the kingdom of glory. Individuality. The gospel deals with groups, institutions. Well, it does, but more importantly, individuality. We're kind of afraid maybe to talk about that because it kind of sounds like independent or independence. There's nothing wrong with being independent, but God wants us to come together, learn together, because we make up the body of Christ, but we are individuals as well. And we have salvation that we must work out in ourselves. The gospel deals with individuals. Here is the LA class. Individuality. Each has an individuality separate and distinct from all others. Each must be convicted for himself, converted for himself. He must receive the truth, repent, believe, and obey for himself. He must exercise his what? His will for himself. And it's so wonderful when I have a mother call me up and say, oh, my 10-year-old is understanding this better. How to use the will. How to use the will. Because by the time Jesus was 12 years old, he knew who he was. He knew his mission, didn't he? Yes. And so we must help our children, especially, grow up to be self-governing and have that personal relationship with God. No one can do this work by proxy. No one can submerge his individuality in another's. Each must surrender to God by his own path and the mystery of godliness. Each must surrender to God by his own act and the mystery of godliness. This is really talking about true psychology. And hopefully, the time is just unbelievable how fast it goes. Because I would like to get into the brain, the mind, the will, and all that today. But I wanted to get through some of these two, slides. Many look to their ministers to bring the light from God to them, seeming to think this a cheaper way than to go to the trouble of going to God for it themselves. Such lose much. Who was it that was taken to the temple at 3 years old?
Samuel.
And do you remember when someone was calling Samuel in the night? greater knowledge of his will, and thus be gaining a valuable experience. For want of this very experience, brethren professing the truth walk in the sparks of others' kindling. They are unacquainted with the Spirit of God and have not a knowledge of his will and are therefore easily moved from their faith. Okay, I'm going to stop here with this. I'm sure I could go on, but I want to share some things. Starting over here at the sanctuary, what was it that went around the court? What was it that went around the court? A curtain, right? A curtain, and I heard linen. And what color was it? White. Okay, so that's one of the reasons I wore this white today. Linen. Okay, to remind us of what? What? What's the white paper in front of you? What does that remind you of? Pardon? Say it. You can say it.
Righteousness of Christ.
The righteousness of Christ. Okay, his purity. So that is the curtain around the sanctuary. And then, of course, the tabernacle had a curtain around that. Well, more than a curtain. It had a number of layers. So Christ's righteousness. So that's what he wants us to see. Did you know that's what people see when they look at you and how you're dressed? They can tell whether you have God's righteousness or your own. Just by how you dress. Well, I woke up this morning. Let's see if I can find my system. And I woke up at 1:30. I said, Father in heaven, are you sure you want me to get up now? I have a big day tomorrow. A big day. So, yeah, he said, I want you to get up. So I got up, and these things were going on and on in my mind. And one of them was, of course, the law of life, which is what? Living to give, and God is the source, okay? Then yesterday I was impressed with the well of life, the wells of life, so the water, you know, the wells full of water. Jesus telling the woman at the well, I had living water for you, living water. Wells of life. Then I was thinking about the road. There's the road and the path. The road and the path. And last night, did you hear prayer meeting?
Mm-hmm.
Verse 3, what? Beatitudes.
Mm-hmm.
Beatitudes. Beatitudes. Yeah, everybody here have good attitudes? I didn't have good attitude when I was growing up. So I'd have to stop and my father would say, look in the mirror 50 times.
Mm-hmm.
As if that would clear up my attitude. But he didn't know. Now I know. Okay, so then there's, so that is a road. This is a ladder. And who is the ladder? Jesus. Jesus is the ladder. And who goes up and down the ladder?
Angels.
Angels. What's in here? Could you pull that out? Does it look like an angel? You must not be seen very clearly. You don't like skeletons? Oh. You need a good attitude. Okay, you just not see him. All right. Okay, so is there a ladder? Do you see a ladder on here? The ribs? Ah, the spinal column. The spinal column is a ladder. And when you look in Gray's Anatomy book and you see each of the discs and right in the center where the cord goes down, cord, if there's a shape, what's that shape?
It really
looks like wings.
Mm-hmm.
Wings.
Mm-hmm.
Wings. So when I came in this morning, Where's the head? It's right here. This is heaven. Heaven. And that's where Jesus sits, right? And so he wants, and he is, but actually it's the Holy Spirit that is sending the angels down to us. When you pray, the Holy Spirit comes, but he also sends angels. We don't hear about that. But he sends angels, and they go up and down, just like the nerves go up and down the spine, and then the nerves go out to the hands and the feet. So when I want my right foot, you know, when you're well, okay, my brain is telling my feet to move and my hands to move. So if God is dwelling here, if you have surrendered your mind to him, your will to him, he gives it back to you sanctified, which means what? Holy. And not just holy, but down here at the end of time, most holy. Then your feet and your hands are going to, your hands are your works. Your hands are going to do your work no matter what it is. Sweeping, mopping, toilet cleaning, or teaching, writing, sewing, whatever it is, your and the angels, like the nurse going down to the hands and the feet, are going to be controlling, doing most holy work. And your feet, they take you on that path. They take you on that road. And so they will be doing also, if Jesus is on the throne here and not self, you will be on that narrow road. You will walk that narrow road. Your hands, your feet, and the mark of the beast. We talk a lot about that. We tell people about the 2300-day prophecy and the end times and not receiving the mark of the beast. What does that mean? Yes, we know who it is and what it is, and we can tell people that. But how many children act like beasts? Yeah. Because they are being trained, right? From the cradle. They're being trained. So like we said about Jesus with his early training, by 12 years old, he knew who he was. He knew what his mission was, and he set out to do that mission. Now, the image of Christ is going to be in those that don't have the mark of the beast. The image of Christ, what is that? It's his character. We're going to be compassionate. Last night we heard about being tender-hearted, merciful. All those beautiful character qualities on Matthew 5, that's the road. Here's the ladder, that's the road. And we also heard last night that it's in a line. That's orderliness. And you don't skip ahead just like you don't skip rungs on the ladder. You climb one rung after another to get us to charity. And so we can see if we're defective in any of these areas, we need to go back and add diligently the truth. So all these things were coming to my mind this morning. And then I was thinking about this too. Okay, I'm gonna pass these four pieces of cloth around. What I want you to do, each individual, is I want you to check out each cloth. Look at it, feel it. You can pull on it, you can do all kinds. Look at the edges, look at it, and the next one, and compare the two. Are they the same, or are they different? How are they different? And then this, what are these? Are they alike, any of these, or are they different, and how are they different? We're gonna start with Mildred, and you can just pass them around. I want you to think about that. And how spiritually that can remind us of something. Okay, so I was thinking about how easy it is for us, if we're rich down here at the end of time, to have this primitive godliness. How easy is it if you're rich? And let me tell you, yesterday and the day before in call quartering, we were combing Columbus in the car in the rain. Looking for places. I heard, let's not go to houses because it's raining too hard. Let's find apartments. So we're looking all over Columbus for apartments. Yeah, apartments. But we went by some of the most amazing houses. They weren't just houses, they were mansions. They were incredible. I said, let's go there. Let's go see some of these rich people. But no, we didn't want to go to the rain. So how easy is it for a rich person to go to heaven? Not very. Okay, so I have some things in my bag here to remind us of. Okay, so what's this? Sewing kit. How many of you don't have a sewing kit? 2, 3, 4, 5. Well, I tell you what, I'll just put them out, okay, and then we'll talk later. Okay, so these are all sewing kits. And so what is it about a rich person that, here's some really giant needles. And these are some really tiny needles here. So what is it about a rich person that they're not going to make it to heaven?
There's a call out of Australia that has the ministry. It's the bruised camel, that's what he calls it.
The bruised camel.
Because all the people are incredibly wealthy.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So the bruised camel. So what are you trying to do? Can you thread a needle? I'm looking at, especially the men. Can you thread a needle?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
And you can sew? Can you sew? You can sew on a button? Good. You can sew. Can you thread a needle? Oh, I would love, okay, before the end of this month, I'd like for you, though all those that cannot thread a needle, to thread a needle, that's part of your assignment, okay? And sew a button on. And I have a lot of buttons. Because I'm thinking about the head, okay? Do you have buttons in your head? I tell you, this is so fun. So fun to learn. And we don't have to. Is it time to go?
No.
Okay, well you look up buttons and how buttons, they're not called buttons in the head. They're called boutons.
Boutons.
All right, you want to spell it?
B-O-U-T-O-N-S.
Boutons. And tomorrow you can tell me what boutons do in the head, in the brain. B-O-U-T-O-N-S, boutons, and where those boutons are, okay, in the head. And, oh, I was going through all the senses, let me tell you, I could have had all my body parts up here, not my body models, when I thought that, I thought, oh no, this is going to be recorded, and people today are just so, you know, they're not there in their head. It gets literal. But I have models, and that's how we study is through the models. They're not real. Though we do get real, like cow and lamb and things, organs to dissect. Do you like to dissect organs? Yes, and I know you have to go. So we'll pray. And because there's so much more. God, He is so amazing. Let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, thank you so much for teaching us. You have so many ways to teach us, and we want to learn, and you have made it so really easy and beautiful, but man's made it so hard and so complicated. Yours is complicated too, but you want to take us a little here, a little there. And you really want us to remember, not to forget. So I pray that you, each student today, help them to climb the ladder and walk the narrow path and have good attitudes. The only way they can is by seeing your face, hearing you speak to them, and of course spending time with you.
early in the morning before the day comes up, and you just walk with us all day long. You walk with us even if we don't get up early, but it's so much better when we have fresh in our minds that fresh manna. So be with our students and be with all those health guests too, and staff members that are sick and are in need, and be with the counselors and those meeting the needs of all the sick today. Be with them. Thank you in Jesus' name.
Do you want me to turn it off?
Yes, we need to do it. Yes, another man not trying.